didn't go away, but I have this incredible sense of well-being. It's okay. He's never failed me.
Never failed me.
Never failed me.
PM.
For those of you that enjoy the music of Sunlight Broadcasting Network, you need to take advantage of this offer. Featuring several of our singers. The first one, Daryl Mann, Daystar. This is going to be a blessing to you. Randy Knapp's Praising the King of Kings, the Larson Family, here we are. Bob Henderson, Glory Hallelujah, and then SLR presents Bob Henderson. Each one of these albums is going to fill your heart all with the presence of Almighty God. Here's what we're doing. Each one of these albums completed in this offer, $45. You need to take advantage of this very special offer. Get to the phone and put this offer every one of these albums, which are going to be included, will be a blessing to you. Get to the phone, go online, and get this very special music offer.
We hope you enjoy Season 2 of the SBN Original Program, Preachers, Patriots, and Prophets. We're now offering the entire season of 7 episodes on DVD. You'll examine the lives of some of America's well-known founders who built the framework of this great nation, whose guiding principles were based on the Word of God. To purchase the DVD, Preachers, Patriots, and Prophets, Season 2, go to shopjsn.org.
The call of God is the highest calling on the face of the entire earth.
I want to encourage you to prayerfully consider becoming a part of World Evangelism Fellowship. If you're a pastor, an evangelist, a teacher, and you believe in the message that we preach on Sunlight Broadcasting Network, the message of the cross, and you're not affiliated with any organization, please prayerfully consider becoming a part of World Evangelism Fellowship.
It's God who has called you.
You did not call yourself.
Whether you're a pastor, an evangelist, whether you're a teacher, whether you're working in prison
picks
if you want to join them. You can go online on our website and download all the information. It's World Evangelism Fellowship.
Just about a few minutes from the Canadian border, and it's It's as far north as you can go. And so, but come be with us Friday morning, Friday night. I'll be ministering 6:30, 10 a.m., 6:30 p.m. on Saturday, and then Sunday at 10 a.m. So be with us if you can. That's the end of June.
John, both of you and Josh, has there been any more rockets fired from Lebanon in Israel in the last day or so?
No, sir, there has not been any of those things, but there are a few small developments that I think are important. What's called the Kerem Shalom, which is the area where humanitarian aid was going into Israel, or into the Gaza, I should say, that was bombed the other day, as we mentioned, by Hamas. That has reopened, allowing humanitarian aid to get back into that area.
Excuse me, where is that?
That is in the south of Gaza, heading towards the area of Rafah. It's a passageway, a roadway, that allows humanitarian aid to go into the Gaza. The Hamas bombed it to prohibit aid from coming into their people, so they could use that as an accusation against Israel, causing the problems.
Were they claiming that Israel bombed it?
No, they were bombing it, claiming Israel was not allowing humanitarian aid to come in. They bombed it so Israel would close it, which they did.
Yeah, they had.
Israel closed it, but then they just reopened.
Exactly.
Because the problem is that, really, the reports, especially from the UN, whatever that's worth, is that the famine, the starvation, the problems are getting very severe. So it's making for a very negative picture. But again, all the blame is going on Israel as being the fault. So we want the people to always keep that in mind, that what these groups like Hamas do is they will launch their offensives, and then it will cause a reaction that they know is going to happen, and that they will pin that on Israel. So right now, the humanitarian issues in Gaza, it's not a good situation. But again, Israel had to close that because they bombed it. And so to protect the people, they had to close it down. But they just reopened that that crossing, and so we'll see if it, you know, changes anything.
Exactly. Another couple issues that are a thought process. The president and his administration yesterday did give the reason why they're not passing on those weapons to Israel, these 2,000-pound bombs, smart bombs, is they don't want Israel to use them illegally. So they're opposed.
Illegally.
Yeah. They want them to abide by international rule. Well, the whole world is saying don't go in and attack the Hamas in Rafah. But Israel's saying we need to do that. So the reason Joe Biden is withholding those weapons is because he wants to make sure their end use is legal. So that is the reason why he's withholding it instead of helping them
hypocritical.
With precision-guided type missile systems that will help war bombs, that will help target Hamas. They're going to prohibit them from using that strategy.
Well, does Israel have any similar weapons they can use?
I'm sure they have something in their stockpile, but they've not revealed what they have as far as what's in stock. But I would hope they have sufficiency. But they still have ground troop opportunities and technology that can help them find Hamas. Other things that greatly concern me is most of our labor unions are now pro-Hamas backers. They are supporting the protests. The United Auto Workers Union, the Service Employees International, the SEIU. These organizations are very large and have great influence even towards the election, and they are now all supporting the pro-Hamas. But let me understand this. Aren't most of these unions today virtually communist organizations? That's how I see it. I've never been in favor of unions, and especially now they have become so progressive. Now, the other thing that really concerned me today, Brother Swagger, is the IDF found a significant amount of advanced military equipment in the Gaza. So the Chinese have now been assisting and helping Hamas, giving them components and things to help them not only technologically but militarily to defend themselves and also bring offensive war against Israel.
Did you say Israel found
Israel found Chinese military sophisticated equipment in the Gaza. So the Chinese are finding a way to get some of those things into the Gaza area to build up the military.
Well, I'm sure that Israel confiscated that.
They did. But here's the other side. Last week, China began withholding certain electronic components. China is very helpful, and they have the mineral systems that help build certain components for computers. And they had a trade agreement with Israel. Now they're withholding not all, but just one or two components of that technology. But, you know, if you're trying to build something, if you're missing something, you can't build it.
Right.
I'm talking about electronics and other technological help. So Israel has now been sanctioned or boycotted by China, yet China's helping Hamas. So we're seeing, once again, the surrogate war that's being fought in the Gaza Strip with Hamas. Nations like China, nations like Iran, their surrogates, such as Hezbollah, Hamas, are receiving help from large industrialized nations. We call them third world, but they're really large industrialized nations that are helping the Hamas fight against Israel. Proxy wars all over the place.
So they're helping the people who attacked Israel on October 7th.
That is correct.
And the way that they attacked was just inhuman, period.
That is correct. But that narrative is not discussed any longer. I'll say this for President Biden. Yesterday he spoke in relation to the Holocaust Remembrance Day. And he did say that he had not forgotten October 7th. Now, what weight that has over all of the actions that he's taken, he's saying one thing, but he's doing other things. But at least he made the statement that he had not forgotten October 7th and talks about the ironclad support that the U.S. has for Israel's security. Now, again, security in their minds means Israel should not go into the Rafah, but they should protect themselves. But the way they protect themselves, I might add, is by eliminating Hamas.
But if they keep lobbing rockets over, whoever does it, after a while, it's
going to be
important.
That is correct.
And it's going to cause some real problems. Israel's going to be forced to take measures again.
And that's what they want to see happen. They want to provoke Israel to react or overreact so that narrative can be judged by the world and once again Israel to be implicated
in
excessive force.
Everything is designed to make Israel look bad.
So more hatred can come. I went back in the last few days and I've been rereading the Protocols of the Elders of Zion. It was a well-known forgery written many years ago, but it's one of the most highly sold books in the Middle East. So there's still this conspiracy idea that Jews were actually planning. No one knows the exact scene that the book is trying to explain. Some claim it was the first meeting at the sill of the Zionist movement that took place with Theodor Herzl. Others claim it was another meeting. But there was a secret conspiracy of Jews that wanted to take over the world. Brother Spired, if that is true, they've done the worst job possible that could be done. They're accused of controlling everything here in the United States. They're accused of controlling the financial systems of the world, which is obvious. Anyone who has a pinprick of common sense that knows these things knows they don't know that they don't have that type of influence. If anything, they have the least amount of influence in the world that one can see in this hour.
Well, this business taking over the world, that's crazy. It's just stupid. You have to be a little loose in the head to believe something.
Hitler succeeded with that, Brother Slayer. That is what his playbook was and his mind called for.
Who?
Adolf Hitler.
Oh, yes.
He succeeded in persuading the German people, intelligent people, Christian-based thinking people, to accept his lie that the Jews were the cause of all of Germany's problems. Yes, deception works powerfully. Education doesn't stop one from being deceived.
But if they would let Israel alone, I think that this thing would come out much better. It would take a little more to destroy this organization. But that's what they need to do.
Brother Sire, and as much as I would like to agree that they need to eliminate Hamas, Hamas has tentacles in over 80 countries now. I'm going to write some articles that will air by the end of, or be printed by the end of this year, showing the history of how this organization has splintered itself and created, not only here in the U.S., but it's all over the world. You cannot separate Hamas from Muslim Brotherhood ideology. They're the same creature. It's the same creature that fed Al-Qaeda, the Arab Spring that took place. It's the same creature that fed the doctrine that runs ISIS. It's the same doctrine that has basically permeated all of the world pertaining to this need for spreading Islam.
The powers that be, they have the same access to the material that you do.
In fact, I was just reading a very important book written, many authors in the book, but General Boykin, who was a guest in the past on your wife's program. We aired with him. Ron Trento, John Guardola, who's also been a guest on your wife's program, they wrote a book called SEAL Team. I think it's SEAL Team V2, and they showed how, in the book, that the Muslim Brotherhood and Hamas came into this country, along with other books, but they corroborate good information. They do know, many of our leaders do know this, Brother Swigert. Why they're allowing it to happen is the question. Does it meet the agenda of the progressive slash communists slash Democrat Party to use them to their advantage? Possibly that's the case. But the reality is, I believe they do know what's going on. Now, does Joe Biden understand it? I don't think he understands very much, to be honest with you. But his handlers do understand it, and they're allowing this to fester and happen. And it has happened for 40 years in our universities. This is the outcome of what has already infiltrated society.
Do you think it can be stopped?
If we have an administrative change, and one that is honest and looks to put a name such as, we've got the Hamas labeled as a terrorist organization, but also create and name the Muslim Brotherhood as a terrorist organization, and then enforce what it means to support these terrorist organizations, I think we can at least stall, maybe not stop, but stall its spreading in the United States.
Well, we have to recognize that when you're talking about these groups, Hezbollah, Muslim Brotherhood, Hamas, these are, I don't want to say, they're pictures, they're covers, they're pieces. But who's behind them is what we also have to look at. You're not going to eliminate Hamas or any of these groups unless you eliminate Iran. I'm not advocating we do that, but there's reports coming out in
Iran or Iran?
Iran. Iran, sure. But this country is behind so much as far as funding these things, and they're taking credit for it now. We know that.
And they've been given the money the last few years.
Exactly. So we can talk about what Hamas is doing all day long, and we should. But if we turn around and give billions of dollars to Iran, what's the point?
Well, they can't, you know, they can't, they don't know that what Iran is doing.
This is what Dad is just saying. They have to, and they do.
Yeah.
This is why anybody with a modicum of understanding of what's going on, it's totally perplexing.
Well, are they doing it just to get, hopefully get some votes?
Well, so, yeah, this situation with Gaza has created, it's a very charged situation now, and we see that. It's become very charged. It's created a lot of polarization in this country, but it also has become a very significant issue to the voting base, and it does, more than anything at this point, it stands to actually cause President Biden to lose votes, because there's been a lot of people that have said, if you don't start condemning Israel and supporting the Palestinians, we're not going to vote for you. There's been a very big movement in this country, especially within the Muslim
community.
Well, there has, but the problem is that's caused the president to change direction and become far more, I should say, far less in favor of Israel. And but the fact is this, we've got nations in this world, Iran would be the case in point, that are supporting terror. And I will give President Trump the credit to say that at least the man was willing to stand up and identify Iran as being the threat to the world that they are. Now, there's others in Congress that would say the same thing, but you don't enter into agreements or allow them to do what they've been doing and then unfreeze billions of dollars. I don't care if it was theirs or not. That's the dumbest argument. They're funding terrorism. You don't allow them to receive funds.
Right.
You just don't do that.
Right.
So, but as far as what's happening in Israel, there's really not a resolution that's going to come to this, but I can tell you what needs to happen, and we've said it many times. What needs to happen is Israel needs to be allowed to finish this skirmish that's going on right now, which would be to basically eliminate as much of Hamas as possible in Gaza. But it doesn't need to stop there. They need to then take back the Gaza. They gave it away in 2007.
Sorry.
Big mistake. Huge mistake. Fix your mistake. That's what I would say. Take the land back. The Palestinian people will then be under Israeli leadership, Israeli government. And it doesn't need to be a self-governed thing. They don't need to create some area that's governed and overseen by other Arab nations. I think we've seen in Jerusalem what a mess that is. They need to take it back, and what is Area A now needs to become Area C. And that's it. And that would be, I think, the best solution that Israel could have, because then they would at least have oversight and control to prevent further escalation.
When this massacre took place, that's what I thought would happen. I thought they would take it back.
Should have happened immediately.
Well, they were delayed because of public pressure, U.S. pressure, so Israel delayed.
Yeah, I'm sure. Yes.
And that's why the problems happened. If I could take just a brief moment, give you a little history to answer your question a little more thoroughly, is do our leaders know about this? Let me give you an example. Back in around the early 2000s, there was an individual named Isabari. And what they did was they raided his home in Virginia. And the reason they did that was they had found a lady taking pictures of a particular bridge. I think it was one of the big bridges. And her goal was to take pictures of it because strategically it was believed that it was going to get blown up. So they raided this man's house, and they had a subfloor in his house. And in his house, they found a memorandum that talked about a civilization jihad. And this was used in evidence in the Holy Land Temple, or Holy Land trial that took place in Texas, where there were organizations. This organization was the largest Muslim charity in the country, and they found that they were directly funding the Hamas. Millions of dollars were given. There were five or six individuals that received sentences. Sentences that were anywhere from 10 years to 65 years in prison. The organization itself was disbanded. It had 10 counts of conspiracy, etc. So this was discovered. There was a significant case that was presented in 2000 and 2008. And this evidence was brought forth. Hamas was labeled a terrorist organization, so any help with providing financial support to them was considered against the law. It exposed what the Holy Land trial did, not only with the funding to Hamas, but it also exposed the plans of the Muslim Brotherhood in the United States with that memorandum. Years ago in your wife's program, I went through some of the memorandum, but it talks about a civilization jihad taking over our schools, taking over the media, taking over offices in government, infiltrating every area and persuading them to recognize that Islam is not the problem. But the very fact is, those in that element want to take over the country. They want to change our laws. They want to bring people into office so that there's a significant voice, quote unquote, for the Muslim community. But what the Muslim community in this sense wants to do is change to Sharia law. Brother Swagger, I know many may think this is insane, but they're in a religious war. They're not thinking politically. They're using their religious fervor and persuasion and the sympathy of Muslims in this country and others that are now sympathizing with the Muslims to use a narrative to make America look bad, make it look like we're trying to destroy the Palestinians. That's why they can march around with Palestinian flags. They're burning American flags. They're destroying monuments. Right now in the George Washington University, the police had to disband another large uprising. They have defaced and debased many of the monuments, including the George Washington statue that sits right out in front of the...
How much would Iran put up with this if we were in Iran?
Brother Schneider, they're arresting women that don't wear their headscarves in public. No, they wouldn't put up very well. The homosexuals, we saw it during the Arab Spring. What were they doing with them? They were taking them to high buildings and throwing them off.
Right.
Splattering them on the ground. They would not tolerate this stuff. But they're using it, and that's exactly what that memorandum says. They will use naivety for their benefit. So all of these idiotic college students are just useful tools in their hands. Sadly, many of the professors are too.
Yep.
They're succeeding in their civilization jihad far more
than like one of them African Nigerian movies all day.
Mr. George Bush left office. He had a number of Muslims financial scholars come in, and he introduced them to all the banking communities to talk about Islamic finance. It's a little bit unique. I won't bore the program with what it is and how it works. But again, looking at alternatives, and what the U.S. is trying to do is find ways that we could spend more money, go into more debt without it making it appear we're going into more debt so we can continue with these agendas. People may not like this, but Bush and his family and others, they're not so friendly to the U.S. as people think. So I'm not going to... They're not so friendly to the U.S. as people think. I get a little concerned, but I won't get into that now. But I am concerned about this. We are seeing the manifestation of what has been percolating now for many years.
And if we don't, at least have an administration that comes in and is honest about it and thwarts it, or at least slows it down, it will continue to escalate.
Do you think that Trump has the strength to do that?
I think he has the resolve to do it. Now, again, how much pressure is he going to get? Let's face it. He's got pressure from within. He's got pressure from without. He's got pressure from above and below. How much he'll be able to accomplish, will he be able to create and put together a cabinet that will be sufficient, giving him the correct advice, the good advice, and their support? In his first administration at the beginning, he didn't have that. Instead, he accused of letting all these people go. Well, a lot of them turned out to be chameleons. They weren't exactly what they said they were, and they changed their appearance a little later on the equation. So that's the danger you have, is a lot of people say what people
I
had a former student of mine, she's a PhD student at the University of Massachusetts, and was in her graduate housing last night and showing protests happening live on their campus. There were over 600 protesters, and the cops were called in. It was a pro-Hamas protest. There are students at these universities that are not involved in all of this foolishness. They're just trying to study. There are a lot of Christian students in our colleges that are just trying to get their degree, do whatever field they're in. So we can just remember to keep those in prayer, because these protesters are paid, they're coming in, they're organized, they're not students. She talked about how all of these people, this mass of people, students there, they came from the outside. So when these police, these campus police and local police that aren't doing anything, luckily in this protest, they did come and take care of this pretty swiftly, but there are just safety concerns, obviously, and there are those that are not involved in all of this foolishness that are just trying to study, just trying to get their degrees.
Right.
So if we could just remember those students, because you know there are a lot of good Christian young people who are in secular universities that are now caught up in all of this foolishness as just bystanders, that and even the pressure that they receive from their other students to participate or be involved. There's a lot of students that said no. There's a lot of schools that are not allowing this kind of thing. So I just wanted to make mention of that, because that just happened to be close to me, because I know this individual personally. And so she's thankfully the riot police came in, they dealt with it pretty swiftly, and they arrested people and hauled them off. But that's not always been the case. There's been a lot of just unsafe and crazy stuff going on at these universities.
And what needs to happen, Dr. Watts, is students like your friend and others, they're going, and this is what I would do if I was enrolled in a university that was allowing these protests to happen. I would be in the office of the president of that college and other professors' offices every single day. They would learn to know my face very well, and I would be protesting to them my disdain, and I would be calling them to the floor to say, as a student of this institution, that if I complete my courses, I'll have a piece of paper with your institution's name on it, and I'm giving you a lot of my money. This is unacceptable. You're going to answer to me as a student. I would love, because you bring up a good point. It's not the majority of students at these universities. Now, you look at the media, it's a whole other picture. But the majority of students at these universities, especially Christians, you're going to have to grow a backbone. You're going to have to get the nose out of the book for a minute and stand up and realize, number one, these professors are not God. If anything, they're influenced by the devil most of the time. And outside of their little bubble that they teach, they be perfectly candid. But they need to stand up to these people and say, listen, you need to knock it off. And then they need to go to the leadership and say, enough is enough. This is going too far. Brother Swagger may disagree with me on this, I know. But you know, neither of us are attending any protests.
Well, no, that's a college president, so it's very slim.
Well, you know Gabe, so that's good enough. But seriously, I don't want my humor to detract from the spirit of what I'm saying. Students with dignity and respect, so don't use the word squat, but with dignity and respect,
Do it manual.
Stand up and go to their professors, go to the leadership at their institutions
or
and say,
have both
we don't approve of you allowing these protests. Brothers, one thing I found is this. When you have the news media and all this going on, but when you have enough people that come together and stand up against whatever the mainstream is doing, a change will happen. What example can I cite? I think back to the 2016 election. They were not expecting Donald Trump to be president to come out of that. But enough people stood up, went and voted, and said, no, we're going to make a difference here. And we had 4 years of an administration that at least started moving us in the right direction on some things. So I do absolutely. They don't want people to do that. They want people to be intimidated, to be scared, to think that there's going to be repercussions, whatever the case might be. But the reality is, the students that do not approve of what's happening on their college campuses need to stand up and let their voices be.
You're saying that some of those professors were put under pressure.
Absolutely. Absolutely, 100% if they were put under pressure.
Same thing as with school boards.
Yes.
Same thing with local politicians.
Look, if you're paying the tuition, that means you're paying their bills. Which means you, respectfully now, have every right to make your voice heard. And if enough voices will come together, they will make a difference, yes. And look, the fact is they can do that. If they were in Iran, you couldn't do that. You'd be done, executed, gone.
They've been doing that for years. That's the world that keeps it going. Keep going back.
Yes, foolish. Let your voice be heard. And but if you remain silent, it's almost as though, in some cases, you're giving a passive approval to these things.
Well,
Christians need to hear what you're saying.
Especially
not just talking about students at college campuses, but in this country, the church needs to stand up.
That sermon will preach right there. That's the truth.
You know, we know their playbook, Brother Spire. There's a book written called Rules for Radicals, and this book was written many years ago by Saul Alinsky, and it gives the actual points on how to create a revolution, and he gives credit to Lucifer. In the beginning of the book,
Hillary Clinton started him.
That's exactly right. He gives credit to Lucifer because he had the first successful revolution against God and succeeded, according to the
book.
Who didn't finish
the book? I thought you didn't read the end of the book.
No, I understand that, but the point is, these individuals that they're influencing, they're only reading the narratives and the process. The college professors follow this. This book is actually taught in universities as one of the books that for summertime reading students should look at. So they're given instructions on how to function in a revolution, the way to do it, and the points of strategy to be used. So we know what they're doing, and if you look at the book, and I encourage people to read it, know what your enemy's doing, they will see Satan's operation and how he works. We're talking about spiritual warfare here in Ephesians chapter 6. We'll understand it in terms of how it manifests in society through what they're doing, because Satan is the author of these revolutions.
That is spiritual warfare just as much as we're not studying.
Exactly. It's the same thing.
Absolutely. Spiritual.
You have the two components. You have, of course, the internal struggle individuals have to be more like Christ. I call it internal struggle, but the idea of understanding the growth of the believer in sanctification. And then we also have the resistance that comes against the believer in terms of our spreading the gospel. So we need to be aware that the weapons, and we're going to talk about the armor we need to put on. We need to be clothed with this armor. Otherwise, we're not going to make it.
We're going to take a break. We'll be right back. Understand what we're teaching and what the Word of God gives us. I think it's never before. Now, this is just like I say, I'm waiting for your call. Take advantage of this offer.
We're embarking on a new journey at Jimmy Swagger Bible College. A journey that's taking us to new heights. A journey that's preparing our students for life. Our message remains the same. Our vision, to take on new challenges. At JSBC, you're not just choosing a college. You're choosing to walk in faith. Our students are preparing for success. Our students are learning how to resolve challenges life brings. Our students are impacting communities throughout the world. And our professors allow the Holy Spirit to guide them. It's our faith that brings us together, and our love for Christ that strengthens us. If you have a calling to ministry, a desire to study music, or a creative passion for media, then JSBC is the place for you. If you are ready to take that next step of faith, then now is the time for you to take this journey with us. Jimmy Swagger Bible College, spiritually minded, academically sound.
This is the Sunlight Broadcasting Network.
I know he could run fast enough to get there.
Finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord. And in the power of his might.
His power is at our disposal. The source is the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
But the means is the cross.
Put on the whole armor of God.
Yes. Not just him, but all.
That you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Yeah.
This refers to the stratagems of Satan.
For we wrestle not against flesh and blood.
Our foes are not human, God versus. Satan constantly uses human beings to carry out his dirty work.
But against principality,
rulers of beings of the highest rank and order in Satan's kingdom.
Against powers.
The rank immediately below the principalities.
Against the rulers of the darkness of this world.
Those who carry out the instructions of the power.
Against spiritual wickedness in high places.
This refers to demon spirits. We're given an inside look here at the spirit world, ladies and gentlemen, that we are against. But there are powerful weapons that are available to us as well. And those powerful weapons are the cross of Christ and the Holy Spirit and the power of God. And Satan cannot overcome that if we go according to God's specifics. Sadly, the church is trying to use weapons that's not of God, to be frank with you. And psychology is one of the greatest efforts being made. And Satan and his cohorts of darkness laugh at that, to be honest with you. You as a believer, if you place your faith in Christ and what Christ did at the cross and maintain it accordingly, I mean, if you maintain your faith in Christ and what Christ did at the cross, the Holy Spirit will then work mightily on our behalf. The Holy Spirit is God. He can do anything. I mean, the powers of Satan are nothing beside him, what he can do. But he demands our cooperation. He demands that we place our faith exclusively in Christ, what Jesus did at the cross, the price that he paid, and the sacrifice that he made, which overcame the powers of darkness. And that is God's way. And it's to be our way, but tragically, we do not know to understand, and we try to do other things. And fasting is another way. It will not give one victory over sin. I know some think that it will, but it won't. It's scriptural. It'll bless you. It'll help you. But it will not give you victory over sin. And the tragedy question is, you can fast for 30 days or 40 days or 10 days or 5 days or whatever, and you'll find that the sin problem is still there, if that's what you're depending on. And you are to simply place your faith in Christ and what Christ has done for you at the cross. Maintain it accordingly. And then the Holy Spirit will work mightily on your behalf, giving you victory over the world, the flesh, and the devil. And the Church of Jesus Christ today is eaten up with sin. It's not, for the greater part, it's not that people want it. They don't want it. Some of them are doing everything they can to overcome it, but they don't succeed. And they're trying to do it outside of God's way, and it won't work. And think about it, ladies and gentlemen. If any way could have been done to give us victory other than Christ and the cross, don't you think that the Heavenly Father would have done that?
Look at what we're fighting against. It's talking about the wiles of the devil. Methodia, that word has the idea of the scheming, the trickery, the deception that Satan uses. They're going to follow the method that Satan is going to bring forth to deceive us. The way we fight that is using the method that God gave us. When we were united with Christ, we were clothed with him. We're in Christ. We're now clothed with Christ, putting on the whole armor of God. We don't fight against it with flesh or carnality. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God that we're pulling down these strongholds. When we're in Christ, he's already victorious. He already defeated these foes that are coming against us. That's why we're not to be ignorant of Satan's devices, the scripture says, because we know his methodia. We know the way he is operating. We know the way he works. Our protection is when we're in Christ.
If you had no drugs, it's foolish.
To stay there and not be drawn out and try to fight this battle in our flesh.
Look at her skin and all that money. Just foolish.
It's to place our faith and confidence in Christ.
But she had drugs.
The cross and maintained it accordingly.
And what's off drugs?
Maintain it. That being the case.
Yeah, what you were going to do, they give you with that, you did it.
Work strictly according to what Jesus Christ did in the atonement.
And if we do that, we'll prosper. We are victorious. We don't stand ready
to... She didn't have that, boy. It's foolish, man. And that's what the basketball player got caught up there, ain't it? That was somewhere in China, wasn't it?
That's
again.
One of the greatest ways.
It's foolishness.
Trying to have victory. If there's a problem in one's life, they conclude that
that's usually going to get away.
And we'll lay hands on that person and cast out that demon spirit. The person will be fine. But have they ever noticed?
Yeah.
The demons are still there.
They shoot one, didn't they? You got it. It's foolishness.
And when we talk about what is our role in this spiritual warfare, notice the word is stand. It's not advance. It's not take territory that the enemy, has and you need. It's what Peter said. He used the word resist. It's standing and withstanding. It's remaining, could be another word. It says Brother Dupree brought out from the word finally. Has the idea of remaining. And so spiritual warfare is holding on to the land Christ has already won for us and not being moved away. The Colossians text in chapter 2 will say the same thing, that any man would spoil you through philosophy or vain deceit. That's one of the stratagems or strategies of Satan. Is to infuse in the mind of the believer another path, another way, and literally spoil, strip us of the covenant blessings of God. The Old Testament.
Still glad you.
And Rabshakeh comes to mind.
the strategy of Satan is clearly defined in that story.
Let me ask you a question.
Yes.
How many Christians know and understand that our victory over the powers of darkness is found in the cross and the cross of God?
I would say that anyone who reads the scriptures should see that. It's not something that you can't hit.
Oh. Well, it's him. Okay. We'll show you his foolishness too.